church, how are we doing? It's God's Feeding Station. It is Sunday, the week after Easter. It's nice to be with you again today. Trying to think about what we were going to talk about today, and I thought, well, Jesus is risen, now what? You know, I mean, can you imagine the disciples after Jesus' resurrection, and he appears to them, and they get over the shock and the wonder and the awe of it, and it's like, okay, well, now what? And we could very well ask that same question, because when you look at Easter, it's the first kind of big church holiday of the year, Christmas being the second. And for a lot of people, they will go to church on Easter and Christmas, but they don't go the rest of the year. So what is it about those two holidays that drives people to go to church? And then what is it about the rest of the year that they don't go, right? So what is next for all of us? And I mean, because you think about it, even after Jesus showed himself to the disciples, there's this period of time where Peter and some of the apostles go back to fishing. They return to their old lifestyle. So, okay, so what's next? Well, the night before he was betrayed, and we're in the Gospel of John, the John account of all of this, Jesus gives all of us, his disciples, and by extension, all of us, instructions on what to do next. And he washes the feet of the disciples in John 13, and then he says to them, "If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that you also should do just as I have done to you. Truly, truly I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Right? Jesus gives them an example of humble service. And the world tells us we'll be happy if we're served. But we know by the example of Jesus that, and mostly by our own experience, that serving others is what brings true joy to our lives. Great example for me, or great experience for me, when I was in the military, we did this volunteer thing for Special Olympics. And it was really cool. I mean, it was heartbreaking, and it brought so much joy. I mean, I remember being on the verge of tears that whole afternoon, because nobody cares who wins or loses, right? Everybody is made to feel special. Everybody is congratulated for just going out there and doing their best. And it was such a cool experience to just see the joy in people when you're standing there just with a bottle of water and a hug for them. And so, you know, when we do those things, we experience that joy of serving. And as our rabbi and as our teacher, as our king, Jesus has every right to demand service from us. And instead, he exhibits what the Bible shows us is Christian ministry. He serves the disciples. He washes their feet. And then he serves humanity, and he goes to the cross. So he reminds us of our place as servants. I mean, if he's washing the feet of the apostles, what should we be doing? We should be doing the exact same thing. We should be operating in our lives a method of service. I mean, Matthew Henry says, we can't be mercenaries in the service of love, nor are we to serve reluctantly. We're to serve unpaid and unasked. We don't wait for the needs to arrive necessarily. We can see where they are. We need to go and serve. Because we're not better than Jesus, not by any stretch of the imagination. You know, if he's humble and willing to serve anyone and everyone, we should be doing the same thing. Because it's interesting, Jesus knows at this point, this night before he's going to the cross, that everything has been given into his hands. He knows that his hour of glory is on the other side of this suffering. And even with that knowledge, he washes the disciples' feet. He becomes and shows yet another example of being the humble servant. He knows that he came from God. He knows that he's returning to God. He had a very clear vision of what lay before him. then he could have had massive contempt for the world, knowing the suffering he was about to endure. And instead, he understands that this is the time that God is nearest to him, and he shows the depths he's willing to go for all of us in going to his death on the cross for all of us. There's an interesting, I read this interesting story this week about Francis of Assisi, and I didn't know this. Apparently, before he entered the service of the kingdom, he was he's the son of a very wealthy man, a guy who was very successful in silks, apparently. And so he was kind of the aristocrat of aristocrats, was very well off. And with all of this, though, he had no peace in his soul. And so one day he's riding on his donkey and he comes across a leper in the street. And normally he would have just ridden by and stayed as far away from him as he could. And instead, something drove him to stop and get off his donkey and go to the leper and embrace him. And the legend has it, as he embraced this guy, the image of Jesus appeared. And, you know, Matthew 25 came to mind when I read this. It was, you know, the king will answer them, "Truly, I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of my brothers, you did it to me." I mean, if we desire his blessing, then we have to serve as he served. And so we move on in John 13, 34 and 35. "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Now, he says new commandment. I mean, is this really new? Like really new? Like, we've never seen this before? No, not in that sense, because we know by just reading Leviticus 19, it says, "You shall not take revenge or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbors as yourself. I am the Lord." So it's not new as in something that's never been seen, but it is new. In the Greek, it's new in the sense of something revitalized. It's like new and experienced, and it's fresh. It's the opposite of worn out. Because in this time, retaliation and vengeance and self-love were the in things. Brotherly love was kind of forgotten, and it's obsolete, and it was kind of out of date. And the love shown by Jesus and about to be shown by him and going to the cross, especially while we were still at enmity with God, was a love that was rarely seen in those days. But Jesus says, "As I have loved you." So how has he loved them? Well, he was kind to them. He never spoke harshly to them. He was concerned for them, for their welfare. He taught them. He counseled them. He comforted them. He prayed for them and with them. He defended them when they were accused by the Pharisees and the religious leaders. He stood by them when they were tired and run down. I mean, he even said that they were dearer to him than his own family. He was compassionate with them. He forgave them. He made them better men. And he was going to lay down his life for them. I mean, greater love has no one than this. And Jesus never thinks, like, what's in this for me? There's not a selfish thought in his body when it comes to his outpouring of love for all of us. His only thought is, how can he give all of himself and all he has to those he loves for the glory of God? And so we have to love in the same manner. We have to follow his example. We must love freely and readily, and we have to work at it. We have to spare no expense for it. It's got to be constant. We have to persevere in it. And we're motivated to love in this manner because Christ first loved us. The other thing is, our reputations as followers of Christ depend on this, right? Because we don't just show love, because anybody can do that. Anybody can fake that. We can talk anybody into thinking we like them or we love them by what we say or how we act. We have to have love in our hearts. This love of Jesus has to be rooted in us. It has to be habitual. It has to be self-denying. And it's got to come from understanding and gratitude for what Christ has done for us. It's got to be present even when there's no reason for it to be present. And it's a choice. It's not a feeling. And by this, he knows his followers. And by this, we know ourselves. Kind of more importantly, the world will know us by this. Because it should be the characteristic of Jesus in us that stands out the most. Because if we don't have this love in our hearts, it'll show. Because the proof will be in the pudding. The proof will be in how we live our lives. And if we don't have this love in our hearts, it's going to show. And what the world will see are hypocrites. They'll point to us and see, look, they don't practice what they preach. So when others need help and when the opportunity for us comes up and for us to gird ourselves and be of service, you know, when people disagree with us or hurt us or provoke us, in these times, the love of Christ will reveal itself or not, depending where our hearts are. So we move on to John 14:22. Judas, not Iscariot, said to them, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him and said, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and he will come to him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. Again, for John, first and foremost, it's about love. Everything of the kingdom of heaven is about love. But now John turns the attention and puts the focus on obedience. Because obedience is an absolute proof of love. I mean, you think about it. Who did Jesus show himself to after he rose from the dead? Was it the Pharisees? Right? Wasn't the scribes? Wasn't the Romans? It was the people who loved him and believed in him. The obedient and trusting love brings about at least two things. One, it leads to safety, right? In Christ, we know that our futures are secure no matter what is going on in the world. The second thing is it leads to a deeper revelation of the mysteries of the kingdom of God, right? God reveals himself to those who seek him, obey him, keep his commandments. Those who don't, they can be used by God, but they really don't have fellowship with him. And is it any wonder in times like that people ask, well, where is God in this? Or how can God allow these things to happen? Those types of questions, they come from a lack of understanding of who God is, who Jesus is, why Jesus had to come, why there had to be this plan of salvation. And that I'm not saying people are stupid or ignorant. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is it's just they don't understand what God's plan was for the world and why there needed to be a plan for salvation. Because if you want to know the hows and the whys, you got to go to the source. You got to go to God's word. You got to ask God to reveal himself in prayer. Take your questions to him because he will answer those questions. But if you don't ask the questions, they will go unanswered. And I've used this analogy before of 9/11 when that happened, there was a lot of that, why did this happen and how could God let this happen? And I've had some people ask me about that now. And I don't know God's heart and God's mind. I know God is in control and I know God is in this and I know God will use this. But as to exactly why now and why this, I don't know God's heart. I don't know God's mind. But what I do know is that we can't just turn to him and ask him those questions in the bad times. My question to all of us, myself included, do we thank God and do we praise and worship him in the good times? It's got to be both ways. And so I think God uses times like this to provoke questions, right? Move people to seek him and ask these types of questions. But I think we have to look at this on both sides of the coin. We have to give him praise and thank him when things are going well. Not just kind of turn and blame him when they're not going so well. So the more we seek God, the more he will fellowship with us and the more we want. Because we're driven and inspired to read more, to pray more, to become more obedient to him because we start to live out this life of faith and we find it changing us and we desire more. I had somebody recently say, you know, well, if I come to faith in God, then I have to change. Well, that's not the way it works, right? You don't change. It's God who changes us. you know, again, it's that thing of the Holy Spirit comes in and you start to experience God, and the change takes over because of what's being done inside you from the inside out. It's not an outside-in change. The Spirit of God is what changes us, because we come to know God more intimately. We become on that almost friendship kind of Abraham thing that we'll talk about here in a little bit. We get close to God. We come to an understanding of God, a deeper understanding of God and what's been done for us. And we desire that change. We want that change because we want to be better. We want to please Him. And we don't want to veer off the path that He has for us. So it's a change from the inside out. And I mean, you think about it, like the more you get to know Him, the more comfortable you're going to be with Him. And that's like with anything in life. I mean, think about the people you're most comfortable with. Who are they? They're the people you know the best, right? The deeper our relationship with God, the more we will yield to His Spirit and the more He will guide us. The more we'll be open to His teaching. The more He'll demonstrate His love for us and to us every day, right? The more we will be molded into the image of His Son. Again, it's not something we do. It's a work of the Spirit. And when we come to this true understanding of what's been done for us, love grows from that appreciation of that free gift. So it takes root in our hearts, and we can't help then but obey. Right? True love for Jesus, we seek that approval. We want to be obedient because we respect His authority and we surrender to God's will. It becomes that second nature. It's that Boaz thing that I talk about so often. You know, Boaz comes in and he shows up at work and he says to his workers, "The Lord be with you." And they reply, "The Lord bless you." And you look at how Boaz deals with that whole situation with Ruth and Naomi. He doesn't even have to think twice about it. It's second nature for him because he's lived that life out and he's grown in that relationship with God. And so he's one of my favorite characters in the Bible. My wife will tell you that. Because it's just so automatic for him because he's lived it out. He's practiced it. He's worked at it. And he gets it. So we continue on. We jump to John 15, 4 and 5. He says, "Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing." Now the vine is something, and when he's speaking to the disciples, everybody in Palestine, in first century Palestine, knows what this is because they're all over the place. They would produce a good crop of fruit, but in order to do that, it needed a real amount of attention, a great deal of attention, because it would grow on terraces, it could grow on the ground, it would grow around doorways, it could grow on trellises. A young vine would not be allowed to bear fruit for 3 years. They would cut it back in order to establish its roots. A vine would bear two kinds of branches. One would bear fruit, the other wouldn't. The one that didn't would be cut drastically back in order not to drain strength from the rest of the plant. And so those who follow Jesus are like those two branches. Some bear fruit for the kingdom, some don't. An example of those who don't or who didn't in those times were the religious leaders. And the Jews who rejected him, right? They wouldn't listen to him. They didn't respect him. They didn't believe in him. So they were withered and useless and would be cut off. Also, there are Christians that are all leaves and no fruit. I think, you know, cowboys use the term all hat and no cattle, right? It's profession without practice, words without deeds. Those who refuse to listen to Jesus or just pay him lip service. William Barclay says, they become useless, and uselessness invites disaster. So again, as Jesus says in Scripture, the fruitless branch is on its way to the fire. Those that bear fruit for the kingdom are in constant communion with Jesus through the Spirit. And we have many examples and euphemisms of this union in Scripture. 1 Corinthians talks about the body and its members, how you cannot cut off a body part and have it survive. Ephesians 5 talks about the bride and the bridegroom. It's a marriage, it's a union, but it's something that you have to maintain and work at to keep that union. John 10 talks about the sheep and the shepherd. The sheep follow the shepherd, they look to him for provision and protection. So there's examples of this closeness and this union all through Scripture, and that is what produces fruit. right? Now, it's not something that produces fruit overnight, because anybody who has a vegetable garden knows that it takes work. You gotta turn the soil. You have to weed it. You have to fertilize it. You have to water it. You have to keep after it, especially with weeds, especially here in Boulder. You have weeds and you let the weeds go, they overtake the garden. So it takes work. Fruit is also not something that's for the benefit of the branches. It's produced for the benefit of others. Proverbs 10:21 says, "The lips of the righteous feed many." So we feed others by our words and our works. You know, examples of bearing fruit are others being brought through Christ or brought to Christ through us. When we grow in holiness and obedience, when we give ourselves and of what we have freely and cheerfully, and when we live out this life of faith and glorify God in our example to others, right? Those united with Jesus bear fruit. And also know, though, it may not always be a bumper crop, because God will sometimes have to do some pruning in order to get the fruit to be in abundance. But a branch that's attached to the vine, that is Jesus, cannot help but bear fruit, because where there is fruit, there is life. Moving on to John 15, 9 and 10. "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love." What does it mean to abide? I think it means to keep fellowship with Jesus so that he can work in us and through us to produce the fruit of the kingdom of God. It involves many things: prayer, being in the word, confession when we wander off, obedience because of our love for him and for what he's done for us. And it's something that, again, has to be cultivated, has to be worked at. It's not something that we can just put on autopilot. We have to make the effort to be in the word. We have to make the effort to be in prayer. We have to make the effort to be in worship. We have to make the effort to be in service to others, to sacrifice. They're things that are done joyfully in the service of God. I mean, Jesus was in constant contact with God while he was here on earth. I mean, you think about the number of times he would just disappear and go off to be in prayer and be with God and spend time with God for long hours at a time. That's what we have to do. We have to keep in constant contact with Jesus. We have to be deliberate about it. It means we arrange our lives, you know, and our prayer and silence in such a way that as the days go on, we're always somehow, some way in contact with Jesus. And we don't give ourselves a chance to not have him present in our lives. Our last scriptures today, John 15, 11 through 17. "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you so that you will love one another." So we're chosen. God in his grace has approached us with an offer that comes from his love. We're chosen for joy. Joy in the knowledge that while we're all sinners, those in Christ are redeemed sinners. Our futures are secure, as I said earlier, and we're heirs to the kingdom of God. We're chosen for love. We're commanded to love one another, not compete with one another, not argue with one another, not fight with one another, love one another. And you might ask, well, what right does Jesus have to ask me, to command me that I've got to love somebody who's driving me up a wall? Somebody who's been, I've been at odds with for such a long time. His answer is this: no man can show greater love than to lay down his life for his friends. I have done that. See, Jesus doesn't ask us, to do anything that he hasn't already done himself. We're called to be his friends. No longer is God far away, behind the curtain, untouchable. We're no longer slaves that have no right to enter into the presence of our master. We're invited into a close, personal relationship with God so that we, along with these great men of faith that we read about, can be counted as friends of God. We're called to be partners. We have the honor of being asked to partner with Jesus for this work of God's kingdom, the Great Commission. Spread the good news of the gospel. We know his mind and his heart because he shares that with us. But we get to choose whether or not we want to be with him and join with him in this mission. We're chosen to be ambassadors. We're chosen to spread the good news of the gospel and represent him to the world. We're chosen to first come to him and then go out and tell the world about him. We're chosen to bear fruit, to be a huge advertisement for the kingdom of God, to bear fruit that stands the test of time, to lead by example. I mean, the best way to spread the good news of the gospel is to live it out. Because we're never going to argue anybody into the kingdom. We're never going to threaten anybody into the kingdom. We attract them to the kingdom. We show how we live in how we live, that there is nothing better than living a life in Christ. We're chosen to be heirs of the kingdom of God. Whatever we ask in his name, God will grant us in accordance with his will. Now, that's not to say God is a genie in the lamp, right? We come to God in faith, in the name of Jesus, selfless, asking him to help us accept the things he brings in accordance with his will. Our friendship with Jesus involves love and obedience, and it also brings knowledge. The more time we spend with God in his word and in prayer, the more of himself he will reveal to us. Dr. Oswald Sanders said to his Bible staff at one point, "Each of us is as close to God as we choose to be." Psalm 25:14 says, "The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes known to them his covenant." So the question for us is, what is next? We have a list of things to do. What are we going to do? Right? In this time, in this crisis, this time of anxiety and all of this, people need to know that they're not alone. People need to know that there's something out there that they can count on. Because what really is essential, right? We talk about essential jobs and all this type of stuff. What is essential? The saving life of Christ is essential. People need to know about it. People need to come to an understanding of it. And it's through us and how we live our lives and how we will react in this time that's going to be the best example of Christ that we can give right now. So the question is, what are we going to do? Y'all have a great day. Be love, right? Reach out to your neighbors, reach out to your friends, reach out to your family. Be there for them, right? You need them. They need you. We're all in this together. We're never going to get through this by ourselves, right? Jesus is inviting us to partner with him in this mission. What's our answer going to be? Y'all have a great week. We'll talk to you soon. Take care. Bye-bye.